theCUBE research shows that new runtimes can deliver up to 75 times better performance using modern platforms. Welcome to this episode of the AppDevANGLE, coming to you live from the Open Source Summit North America 2025. My name is Paul Nashawaty, covering the app dev space and all things open source. I'm joined from Sam from Elide.
Yes.
Sam, how you doing?
Hi, how's it going?
Great, great, great to have you here.
Thank you for having me.
Want to tell the audience a little bit about yourself and about Elide?
Sure, so my name's Sam, I'm a software developer. We made Elide because we were tired of seeing the JavaScript universe expand to the detriment of all others, and we feel like that expansion has really left a dearth of activity in, say, Python or Java, these sort of back-end spheres. So we've made a runtime called Elide, which is basically Node, but from a Java-first perspective.
That's awesome. I mean, when we look at this, you know, we look at runtime platforms that are looking to redefine performance, cost efficiencies, and developer flexibility across multiple programming language, right? Mm-hmm. So these polyglot deployments mm-hmm. are really looking for new ways of doing this, especially with these heritage environments. So I understand that you're built on Oracle GraalVM, right? Mm-hmm. And this is a solution that promises dramatic speed improvements of up to 75 times faster than traditional runtimes, right? Mm-hmm. We were trying to say that up front, right? But while remaining open source mm-hmm. and drop-in ready for existing ecosystems, there's a lot here to think about, but these mm-hmm. are some lofty claims, Sam, right?
Yes,
when
we
think
are.
About that, so why don't we tell the audience a little bit about that?
Sure, so lofty claims require strong evidence, right? And we're independently benchmarked, so the numbers that I'm going to give you here are either from Oracle or from a group called Tech Empower, which independently benchmarks servers. So we're 3 times faster than stock Python, we run Python. We're 75 times faster than Node.js at running JavaScript. We're 24 times faster at running Ruby. And all of this is based on the technology that Oracle has created with GraalVM. These language engines are brand new, they're really well written, they're modern, and they interoperate. So in our paradigm, you can actually use multiple programming languages together. They can import from each other, they can call each other. There's no interop boundary where there's overhead added, right? There's no serialization, there's no process boundary, and I'm getting very technical here, but the point is that it's already the case that many Java code bases or Python code bases also have Node in them. They
right.
have a bunch of Node modules, React, that they want to add for their UI. This lets you put all of that into one system, one tool chain, and use it together.
So when we think about this interoperability across these different polyglot languages, mm-hmm. right, the use cases benefit from these multi-languages capabilities can really be exponential.
Totally,
right?
Exponential.
Can you
mm-hmm.
talk about some of these use cases?
Sure, so one big use case for polyglot, and polyglot isn't necessarily Elide's reason to exist, it's just a natural benefit that falls out of this new model, right? But one big benefit of Polyglot is we can install packages from Maven, from PyPI, from NPM, and so all of a sudden your developers have much more software that they can pull off the shelf to do something without building themselves, right? It nearly triples the ecosystem that you can pull from very easily to use in your app. Right.
Okay, so I open up the session with 75 times more performance, right? That was kind of a little bit of a struggle, but I got it out there. Mm-hmm. But you know, when I think about that, this is across various languages. Mm-hmm. Can you explain that number and how you got there?
Sure, so some of our benchmarks, like the 3x Python stat, the 24x Ruby stat, those are the geometric mean of a language suite of benchmarks that test everything from function calling to arrays to iteration. Then on the server side where we have JavaScript like numbers like the 75x, that's a server benchmark. So that's requests per second, right? And Elide, as an example, can sustain 800,000 plus requests per second on Linux, where Next.js on Node can only do 3,000, right? And so this is a night and day difference, hundreds of thousands of more at RPS.
And right? How do people know about this?
Well, we're open source, we're on GitHub.
Okay.
We've just launched beta about a month and a half ago, and we've seen a great response so far. Generally, when developers find us, they star us, they follow us, they want to know when this is going to be ready, and I think stable for us is probably about 3 months away.
Okay, mm-hmm. so let's talk about that, mm-hmm. because when we think about that, we want to make sure that we put this out there, we get people to understand what it can do. Mm-hmm. You're kind of in the, I'll call it an alpha stage at this point.
Beta for sure.
Beta for sure, okay, okay. That's fair, that's a good way to kind of put it.
Bugs are unexpected.
Of course, that's just the way, the nature of the business, mm-hmm. right? But like, as a drop-in replacement for Node, mm-hmm. right, and Node.js, what challenges did you face with the compatibilities between, the Node ecosystem and the partners that kind of, ensure that parity mm-hmm. between the libraries and the tools?
Sure, great question, actually. So we have the same fight that new alternative node runtimes have, which is, okay. You know, you think of Deno and Bun, all of these companies kind of have to recreate the node API.
Yep.
We have to do that as well, but one big benefit of Elide is we're built on the JDK. So a good example would be reading a file. When it comes to reading a file, if you want to do that in native code, you have to do that on 6 operating systems and efficiently, and it's very hard to do, and so they've got their work cut out for them. We just read a file in the JDK, which is really fast, really well tested, works on every operating system. So yeah, our fight is a lot easier than the other ones going on right now.
So why haven't people done this before?
You know, that's a great question. I think it's because Node was written by Ryan Dahl, who was a particular fan of C++ and JavaScript, and that sort of is what it took for somebody to come along and take V8 and put it on the server with the APIs needed in JavaScript. We have that same bent. We love all these languages, but we're Java Kotlin first, right? And we believe that the JVM and Java and Kotlin give a richer, more powerful substrate to build a runtime in. Here's an example. Java's memory safe. And that means that most of Elide is also memory safe,
okay.
Right? Just by natural default. And so we think about a world where 85% of vulnerabilities and exploits today, somewhere along the line, come from memory safety. Right? I mean, we could eliminate all of those in one go by switching to a better runtime.
Yeah, that's interesting. I think that makes a lot of sense. And when you think about alternate runtimes, it's customer choice. People are figuring out what they want to do and how they want to get there. They also have to look at these barriers that they need to overcome, right? Mm-hmm. And part of it is, I'm thinking about it from the perspective of, we just recently had our App Dev Summit, mm-hmm. and we did a number of bits of research around day 0, day 1, day 2, and you know, build, release, and operations. And you know, one of the things we were thinking about was around the compilers and what's happening in the compilers. And mm-hmm. you know, when we think about it, you make a claim of 20 times faster with, you know, with the compiler here,
yeah.
Right? And that is interesting, because I think it also impacts some of the slowdowns you see in the CI/CD pipeline, right?
Mm-hmm. That's
so
right.
So mm-hmm. if we look at it from that lens, one, validate the claim, right?
Yeah.
Right? Let's talk about that. And two, let's talk about the CI/CD pipeline and,
sure.
and how you can get the release out faster.
Sure. So our Java compiler and our Kotlin compiler are just embedded versions of the standard Java and Kotlin compiler. And what we've done is we've made these native rather than running on JVM. And as a result, there's no warm-up time. So
okay.
it's an identical compiler, but it doesn't take time to warm up anymore.
Okay.
Right? And so that's where we get all of our speed gains, and that's how we can hit exact same inputs, exact same outputs as the standard compilers, because it is that compiler, just treated differently. Right?
I see. Okay.
And so that's one answer to your question. Another answer to your question is safety and security, and all of those guarantees still apply in the compiler phase. Now, I should say the 20x stat is like the fastest case, right?
Okay.
I think users are more likely to see a 10 to 15x gain, but that's still incredible.
Well, yeah, of course it is. I mean,
yeah.
the gain is you know, whether it's 10 or 20, I mean, you're talking about a significant gain.
Free, right.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And so from a you know, tools and integration perspective, there's developers are using their bespoke solutions, they have certain tool sets that they're using, the tech stack they're using. How does this platform kind of have minimal friction, especially when you're looking at existing Node.js or, you know, JVM-based environments?
Sure, great question. So we have plugins for Gradle and Maven.
Okay.
We prefer to meet users where they are, which means we're going to integrate with your build system, we're going to give you APIs that you're familiar with before we design our own new APIs or break you, right? Like, our goal is really to just meet you where you are and do a better job than your current runtime is doing. So we're fully compatible with Java, fully compatible with Python. Node is the only one where we sort of have this longer fight to get to parity, right?
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Gotcha. Okay, I mean, it makes sense. So it's an evolution. Mm-hmm. It's going to get there over time, and it's but your gains that you're seeing is definitely worth the investment.
Oh, users can benchmark themselves. I mean,
sure.
you know, all we do is we compile the same code with Java C and Elide, and it's Elide Java C. So it's, you just put Elide in front of it and see it different, you know?
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. So, all right, let's pivot the conversation. We talked about a lot on the practitioner side, right? We talked a lot about the developers and how the developers are getting, you know, savings. Let's talk about the, you know, the business decisions that are being made here, right? And when we think about this new investment, right, how do we look at, you know, the platform, how it reduces software development costs and cloud infrastructure costs? What types of ROI are you seeing with this?
So ROI is hard to measure on this, and I'm not quite sure what my answer would be there yet, but I'll tell you the two mechanisms by which we save cost, or save costs for our users. Number one is Java developers, Python developers, expensive.
Yeah.
React developers, plentiful and cheap. So how do you get a team of React developers and backend developers to work together? This is a runtime that allows you to interoperate, that both their code could talk to each other, it's seamless, you don't have to throw it away, you don't have to rehire people, right? Like, there's a cultural barrier that we're knocking down here. By doing that, we lower the cost to develop software because those salaries can be lower for React and front-end developers. So that's one place.
Okay.
The other place is by running faster, we can run for less time, and so that cuts your AWS compute bill immediately, right?
Yeah, well, I see that, you know, we can absolutely talk about this economic validation here, because I think it's a big factor in switching platforms, you know, moving to a new tech stack and such. I think that's an important factor to look at.
Absolutely.
But, you know, we will also want to talk about those tangible business values, right? You know, like user experience, you were talking about that, you know, you have the collaboration between teams, faster releases because you have that collaboration.
But faster builds.
Faster builds, we talked about that across the CI/CD pipeline.
Right.
But also revenue impact, right? Because, I mean, you can get this code out the door faster. But anything else that we're missing, I mean, the performance acceleration alone is, is incredible.
Well, you know, one that's hard to quantify is, what would a breach cost you that never happened, right? And like, in a memory-safe runtime, you can be totally sure that there's not going to be some bug where they can escape the VM and steal all of your company's data and have like a cataclysmic breach. That's an impossibility with us, right? And so, closing those gaps for enterprise is what we see as innovation.
Right? Gotcha.
Yeah.
All right, so I have a business question here. You know, like when I think about the MIT license here that kind of goes with this, right? How do you balance the openness between sustainability and the commercial side of making money and support opportunities?
So our answer is open source first, because I think what we build has to be useful for the world, and with open source feedback and contributors and attention, we can make sure it is useful for the world. We want to be oriented towards everybody's needs here. On the commercial side, we have plans where we're going to be providing premium tool chains in JVM and Android. So those are things that companies can purchase to accelerate their build. That's separate and different from our runtime. So the runtime's always going to be open source, always free, right?
Very cool.
Now, those components that we're intending to charge for, in all cases, we charge less than the cost that you would incur for not using our product, right? So they're almost always structured to be a no-brainer.
So, all right, so then I'll ask the question, you know, you'd say you're talking to CTOs here at the audience, right? And we're at open source, and you know, you're talking to them, and they're evaluating these new solutions and how to get there. And you're looking at, you know, whether to migrate an existing workload to your platform or, you know, migrate success stories around this. Do you have some success stories that you can share?
Not yet, we're very early. Okay. but here's what I would say is that what we've seen work with some private design partners is like dropping in Elide as a compiler replacement first, right?
Okay.
Because brownfield projects already use these compilers, they can experience an immediate gain, there's no difference in the output that they receive, so that's just a freebie, right?
Gotcha.
That's where the brownfield projects come in. Greenfield, they have a whole new way to develop software, ship software that's much cheaper than before.
Gotcha, right. Gotcha. Mm-hmm. So we're sitting here a year from now, and the next open source summit, right? Where do you see this all going, and where's it taking off?
You know, I think AI is here to stay in a lot of ways. I think AI is going to be local and sovereign when we get there, right? I think businesses are going to have their own AI in-house. They're not going to be paying Anthropic or OpenAI bazillions of dollars just to run their business. And I think to get there, we need to evolve on the runtime side. So Elide, for instance, can run local AI very easily. So we've made that super easy so that your developers can take your private data, keep it sovereign on site, but have the whole chat interface that you want, right? So, yeah, I think in a year, we're going to be back here. We're going to have a booth.
Nice.
It's going to be the nicest booth, I hope.
That's great. That's great. I know, well look, I mean, I think you've, congratulations on the successes you've had
so far.
This is awesome. I really think you're going to give the industry a run for the money, right? I think it's a great thing. I mean, performance is incredible. I want to thank you for your time and your insights.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah. But I also want to thank the audience here. Thank you for tuning in. We appreciate you being part of the AppDevANGLE community. That wraps up this episode, and we'll be back next Wednesday for another conversation diving into tools, trends, and talent, shaping the future of application development. Whether you're deploying at the edge, building an IT and or AI, or modernizing your cloud stack, we've got you covered. So be sure to follow us on social. If you have any other thoughts, questions, or just want to connect, you can always reach me at paulnn@siliconangle.com. Until next time, stay curious and stay building.